some people have an inspired people, no matter how hard they work, whenever truly begin.
90% of churches in North America are either declining or, if they are growing, it's a pace less than their community.
Welcome to the Vanderblumen Leadership Podcast, where we talk about how to build, run, and keep a great team. I'm your host, Holly Tate. And on today's episode, William talks with Dr. Tom Rainer, the president and CEO of Lifeway Christian Resources. He's also a ministry partner here at Vanderblumen Search Group. Dr. Rainer is passionate about church revitalization. In fact, over the next 3 days, November 3rd, 4th, and 5th, Dr. Rainer is hosting 6 free webinars all about church revitalization. So go to vandercast.com, that's vandercast.com, and click sign up to register for Dr. Rainer's free webinar. Without further ado, here's William and Dr. Rainer.
Well, we're so glad to have Tom Rainer on our podcast today, and glad that you're here with us. Thanks so much for tuning in and for all the comments that you give us. Remember, you can use hashtag VanderCast. We love watching those. When we see a favorite, we've been known to drop a Starbucks gift card in the mail. So be sure and tweet out anything you hear that might be of value to your tribe and hashtag VanderCast. Dr. Rainer, thanks for joining us. We're really glad you're here.
William, and we were just saying offline, and I want to say it online, we have such a great relationship with you, with Vanderblumen Search Group, and I just keep hearing of more and more churches that are coming to you. So I'm just grateful for the partnership, and yeah, I'm happy to be here on this podcast. Y'all are rocking. I'm watching it. It's just rocking. Good stuff going on.
You're very, very kind. I as I thought about how our listeners could gain value from our time with you, one thing that came to mind, people may not know, I mean, people know we help churches find their pastor, but we also help faith-based organizations find their leaders, and we've done some work for you guys over the years.
Right.
It's been really cool to see the public perception of Lifeway from when we first started doing work with you till now. I am hearing, you know, at first it was like, I work at Lifeway, that's the old Sunday school thing, and yeah. I don't know if we do that. And now I'm hearing people excited about the Gospel Project, excited about Lifeway. If I remember right, I was at y'all's State of the Company a year or so ago, and you had a real turning point where things are turning in a really good direction. Can you tell our listeners just a little bit about that story?
Yeah, Lifeway is an organization, big place, about a little over 5,000 employees, but been around since 1891. So it's an old organization. It's denominationally owned, and so that has both its benefits and its challenges. And it's an organization that has a lot of breadth to it, 185 Christian stores. We've had churches as our customers since 1891, a variety of products. We do venues around the United States. We have speakers. And then in addition to that, we publish books and Bibles. And there's so many different ways I could go in for this. Just one tidbit that most people don't know about us. We're the largest publisher of Spanish Bibles in the world.
Wow.
And our fastest growing market is China right now. So we're all over the place. We're doing, I think, a lot of good things, but we still have a lot of challenges. And the challenges that came were obvious from our first day, and it's obvious even today. I don't have any salvific power. I really have followed, I'm very much Jim Collins-esque, and I really believe that if you get the right people on the bus in the right seat, then the organization responds accordingly. But it's not just getting the right people. It has been getting the right people and allowing them to lead. You know, for example, Eric Geiger very well. Brought him on as a youngster, and he's turning 40 in 30 days. He's about to enter the world of not quite as young as you once were. And he came from a megachurch, multi-campus church in Miami, Christ Fellowship. And he has that gift of leadership, and he has developed an organization under him. Same thing with Casi Pacheris in our retail area. Same thing with Selma Wilson in B&H, and Brad Wagner's my EVP, and I could go down the list. And what has happened is you bring these people in, they get good people, and everybody then, the organization gets that flywheel, and you begin to feel the momentum. And so that is what has happened to Lifeway. We had a lot of challenges. We were in the analog age. I'm not saying we didn't do anything digitally, but we weren't fully in the digital world. And there's this little company that we kept looking at over our shoulder called Amazon, and that Amazon company was and is dominating. We had to ask the question, how do we have a viable business in an Amazon world? We've come up with a lot of solutions that are unique to Lifeway. We had to weather the recession that everybody had to weather. And during that time, we put the brakes on a lot of things, but we were able to do so. And at the same time, we're serving this broad constituency all over the world, different denominational, non-denominational churches and individuals, but we're owned by a convention with a specific confession of faith. And so you have all those challenges that are going forth, and do we do them well all the time? No, absolutely not. Are we getting better? I think so. I don't think it's because Tom Rainer, I'm not the brightest bulb in the chandelier, but I know that there are a lot of good people on the team, and we're moving forward. And one little thing that we're doing is we're selling our facilities in downtown Nashville. That's kind of a big thing because we are the longest standing landowner in downtown Nashville, and we're the biggest landowner in downtown Nashville. And this will be the biggest transaction land-wise in the history of the city.
It's kind of like the Empire selling off the Death Star.
Oh, wow. I I'll have to work on that metaphor just a minute. The Death Star is gone. But we have 1.1 million square feet, and we only need 300,000 or less. So why should we be in this big facility and have such poor stewardship? But anyway, I know I'm going in a bunch of different directions, but you ended up at Death Star, so I'll blame you for going down that path.
Oh, I'm just giving y'all a hard time. We love you guys and have loved knowing you. I had no idea the organization was that big till I made my first trip out to do some work for you guys. Now, interesting thing for our listeners that you reminded me of, John Maxwell said to me many, many years ago, he took time with me, he said, William, you know, you're gonna face a time where you're tempted, in order to get a hire made, to hire a 7 or an 8, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10. Right. And that might not be that bad, but the problem is a 7 or 8 will never hire a 9 or a 10 to work for them.
Right.
So hiring those people at the top is a real key. Now, let's try and translate that a little bit. Most of the people listening, if they're pastors, just statistically, and you tell me if you disagree, but I would think most of the pastors listening are at churches that are either stagnant or in decline, because most churches in the country are stagnant or in decline. Is that a fair statement?
90% of churches in North America are either declining, or if they are growing, it's a pace less than their community. So 90% are not keeping up with their community.
Well, as I think about Lifeway and I think about how Amazon sort of disrupted things for you guys, and you guys have been able to turn several years of decline into a new reality where things are headed up. It just makes me wonder, are there some truths you've learned that you could pass on to pastors who are in one of those situations where it's flat or in decline that might help them turn things around?
Well, one of the truths that will be self-evident, but I'm going to state the obvious, is don't abandon your core. There will be temptations as a church leader to chase many different fads, to go in different directions. That's okay, but don't abandon who you are. Don't abandon biblical truth. The vision statement for Lifeway is more of a motto. It's biblical solutions for life, and we describe ourselves as an organization. This is the way we describe it. We are a ministry funded by a business model, and we're always challenged to keep the ministry first, and then the business supports the model. We've been around since 1891. We've never received outside funds. We've always had to support ourselves. And so we've had to stay at the core. There have been temptations at times to go in other directions that may have seemed better, more profitable, but just stay at the core. And understand too, and you know, just like you, William, I deal with a lot of pastors and a lot of church staff. I would say this, that in the midst of some of the toughest times and some of the most discouraging times, understand that God is doing a great work in many leaders right now, and there is no reason to believe that it would not happen to the leaders who are listening to you right now. There's just an incredible thing going on in many churches at the same time, while other churches are challenged and they're not seeing fruit. Here's another little piece of information for, and this will be specifically for pastors, but it could apply to other staff persons as well. Most pastors do not even begin to see significant fruit until after about 5 years. Mm-hmm. And so there may be some pastors who are in difficult scenarios right now, and other staff, and they're saying, will I make it here? With the average tenure of a pastor being less than 4, most don't. And you begin to ask the question, you know, is it worth staying in there? One of the best characteristics of a great pastoral leader or a great staff leader is just perseverance and just hanging in there and seeing what God can do.
What a good word. What a good word. And you've studied church revitalization quite a bit, I know, and actually found some key markers of churches that are able to turn it around. What are the things they do? They remember their core. Are there any other steps that you've seen that are common in church turnarounds that the pastors might want to know about?
Another key to all of it is to raise the bar, is a better way to put it, to raise the bar. We have dumbed down what it means to be a part of God's church so much that people are not doing much at all. It's a matter for many of those who are active in church life to say, I'm just going to sit down and watch, and that's all I'm going to do. You can't go to 1 Corinthians 12 without seeing that when it talks about being a member of the body of Christ, that you are a functioning member, that you are a contributing member. And the churches that are turning around slowly, but still intentionally, whether it's through a new members class or some type of way to raise the bar, are raising the bar, and as a result, you're having healthier church members, and healthier church members, of course, are the repercussions and manifest healthy churches. Another thing that is happening is what I would simply, the word I use again and again, if anybody's ever listened to Jonathan and my podcast, we have a lot of redundancy, and redundancy is there for a reason, and one of the words that just comes back again and again is intentionality. Churches that are moving forward are intentional, and here are the two things that many churches miss on an ongoing basis: intentionality about an outward focus. Not just having a one-time event or not just doing something occasionally, but constantly being Great Commission focused and constantly asking the question, how can we reach beyond ourselves? That intentionality. The second intentionality that many churches miss out on is prayer, and I'm not just talking about personal prayer, but corporate prayer. Now, where do I come up with these? A lot of it's research, but ultimately this comes back to the Bible. And when you look in Acts 2:42, it says they devoted themselves to what? To the apostles' teaching, which was to the Bible that we know today. And then it's to the breaking of bread, to the fellowship, and then it says into the prayers. The results is in Acts 2:47, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So intentionality, some type of entry point where people understand what the church is about, so you can raise the bar, and then just understanding your core and sticking with your core and perseverance. Those are some of the characteristics of revitalized churches and their leaders.
That is really great. And our listeners may not know this, and Tom doesn't know I'm going to tell him this, but you've developed a solution. It's called Church Answers. Is that right? It's kind of a membership, a community that you can get answers to things like this on a regular basis. You want to tell us just a little bit about that so folks know that's out there?
I appreciate you allowing me to share about it. ChurchAnswers.com is a subscription-based membership site, and it provides a whole host of information. For example, you get three pieces of information, usually via video, a month, and so you're getting at least 36. It usually comes to 48, even 45, and it'll be on a particular topic. We have 1 week where we're talking about how to break barriers. We have another week called Deeper Dive, where we're going deep into certain issues and going beyond the superficial level. Then another week called Rhema Report, where I'm typically interviewing someone on one of the latest issues in the church. But in addition to that, We're able to communicate with them in a chat room, and we're able to talk to them on a regular basis. And so it's been really a fascinating thing. And right now, as we're recording this, and not certain when you're going to air this, but as we're recording this, we have just opened the membership part again at churchanswers.com. We open it three times a year.
That's fantastic. And Holly, of course, those of you who are regular listeners, Holly's going to be sending you an email with links for all of those things so that you can be sure and be aware of a chance to enroll, and I just highly encourage you to get involved.
So, by the way, Holly rocks.
Holly does rock. That's right.
Yeah, I got Jonathan, you got Holly, and we're both blessed.
And if anybody out there thinks that their last name is actually what's on the websites, it's not. We're hiding them from everybody.
There you go.
So we talked a little bit about what you do if you're plateaued or declined. There's also a whole lot of listeners. I just don't believe the media. When the media comes out and says church is dying, nobody wants to go to church, everybody wants to be a nun, N-O-N-E, nun, I see church growing. I see explosion. I see, and I think it it's part of a pattern. I think that when there every time in history that there's been a seminal communication breakthrough, there's been a seminal kingdom breakthrough right after it. You know, Rome builds roads, Paul plants churches.
Printing press is built.
Yeah, well, the common language of Greek with Alexander, and you get the New Testament canonized. And then Al Gore invents the internet. Here we are. So I really think there's a lot of growth going on, but some guys don't know how to handle that. So some people are dealing with bigger teams than they've ever had to deal with before. And I know, walk us through your career. You've worked with a bunch of different sizes teams. Just tell everybody a little snapshot of how Tom Rainer ended up where he is. And then let's talk about what it's like to adjust to a bigger team each time you made a move.
All right, let's just go to three touch points, not my entire biography. The last church I served as a pastor had a team of about 12 to 15. I'm talking about the ministerial staff. From there, I went to Southern Seminary, where I served as dean, and again, about 15, maybe as many as 20 on that team. And then I come to Lifeway, and depends on how big you want to describe the team. The entire employment base is 5,300. That's a big team. My executive team is another seven people around me. The entire leadership core of Lifeway, what we call the strategic leadership team, is 83 people. So those are the different types of breakdown of leaders at Lifeway.
And as you moved from the seminary into Lifeway, that had to be a big jump in terms of how many people you're having to think about and how you're having to manage. Were there some lessons you learned along the way about how to scale up as the team gets bigger?
Yeah, the primary lesson I learned is don't think that you can do it all on your own. Don't think you have all the answers. And you make sure, you know, even in a small church, William, I love to see plurality of leadership, because the burden is not all on just one person. And even in larger churches, continue to surround yourself with those type of people that are going to magnify your strengths and minimize your weaknesses. I do two things when I bring team members on, and this is, you really honored me in Lifeway by talking about you're seeing the evidence of the turn. But one thing that I just go through as part of that process was the process of how I decided who I would hire. Have I had a perfect track record? No. But who I brought on the team. One of the first things I wanted to do was to bring someone that complimented me, not bragged on me, but complimented me with two E's, that was strengths where I was weakness, that provided fill in the gaps of gaps that I had. And the second thing that I've attempted to do, and I don't say this with false modesty, I really mean it, it has been my intention to hire people who are smarter than I am. And I think I have been very successful in doing so. It does not intimidate me. It strengthens me, because I know I have such a team that I can lean on. We mentioned earlier in the podcast, we're talking about selling this building, and something just hit me about the facilities and what might take place. And I knew that I could contact any one of my team members. It was about 10:30 or 11 last night, so I texted one of them. I said, this thought just came to my mind. What do you think? Within 5 minutes, Brilliance was in a text message to me.
Wow.
And that's just the kind of team that I have surrounded me. And that has helped me. I don't lead that well. I just hire people who lead that well.
That is the key, isn't it?
It is. And I've just let them go. And because they're smarter than I am, why should I hold them back?
Yeah, I tell our people, I would rather have to rein you back in than prod you along. I would rather see you coming up with a new idea that I hadn't thought of. It. You know, I get questions all the time. Probably we have consultants that work with churches that all have, you know, ridiculous amounts of experience on senior staff. We counted it up recently, and I think we have something like 290 years of ministry experience on our team.
Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And then that's all the consultants. But then, you know, behind them is a whole big team. And it's like there's surgeons, and then there's a whole surgical team behind them. And all that surgical team, they're all under 30. And I learned so much having younger, smart people around me. They teach me things like how to do a podcast, or this studio was built. I'm sitting in a broom closet that got turned into a studio because of a creative 20-year-old who was able to put things together. So
now you're confusing me on one thing. I thought you were under 30.
I'm the not as young as I once thought I was bracket, right there with Geiger.
There you go.
Oh, this has been super helpful Appreciate you being with us, Tom. We do have three questions that we ask our guests all the time.
Sure.
The first one is, tell us a book that you've been reading, maybe you're sitting by your nightstand, and it's just really exciting to you. Two rules: you can't say the Bible, and you can't say Good to Great.
Okay. I think my two books that really are sitting by my bedside right now are going to be a bit obscure to most. In fact, you can tell me, William, if you've heard of them. One of them is Diversity Explosion by William Frey, Frey. An incredible book about demographics and what's taking place. I think every leader needs to have it. I don't think it's a thick book. I don't think every leader will just sit down and read it. It's almost a reference book. Let me just give two examples from that. Two examples from 1 year. In 2011, two paradigmatic moments took place. In 2011, baby boomers started retiring, hitting the age of 65, presumably retiring. And that on January 1, 2011, 10,000 baby boomers hit 65, and now 10,000 are going to continue to retire or hit 65 every day for the next 20 years. What are the implications for that for church staff? What are the implications for that for volunteers? What are the implications for that for other organizations? So that's one. Another one, a Diversity Explosion, is 2011, for the first time in American history, the non-white live births exceeded the white live births. So we are turning into... We know this, but it is now official. We're turning into an all-minority nation. So that's one of the reasons I absolutely love that book. It's plodding to read through it, but it is worth to do so. Another book that I hadn't heard anybody talk about, and it's kind of obscure in that sense, is called The End of Jobs, J-O-B-S. And when I saw it, I thought it was about Steve Jobs. And maybe it was a biography about him through his death. It's written by Taylor Pearson, and it's a fascinating book that says jobs as we know it have come to an end. And you have to start treating your organization, your people, whether they're church staff or anything else, like they're freelance, and that you are their customer of one or perhaps two at the time. The whole idea of the company taking care of someone for a lifetime is over. Jobs as we know it is over. So those are two and they're not in the religious field, but they're the two I have by my bed right now. And I just reread the updated edition of Leading with Change by Cotter, the classic.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I that Cotter book, if you don't have it, it is fantastic. I based my doctoral work on leading change in established churches, and John let me use that template to describe how to lead change in an established church.
Have you published that?
No.
You need to.
Well,
yeah.
I got a few things going on over here.
Okay, I know you're busy, but that's a good stuff. Man, at least let me read it.
We'll do. Hey, one other question we like to ask our guests is, what's an app you're using that's kind of got your attention right now?
Oh, I'm going to give one that's just so common that everybody's going to say, oh, Rainer, do better than that. I love the Periscope app. I have fallen in love with that social media. I love Periscope. I've done some stupid things with it. I have the dominant spiritual gift of ignorance, and I quite often am using that gift. And I'll use that Periscope at some really weird times. I embarrassed my son, my middle son. He's 32 years old. We went to a zoo with his two sons, my little grandchildren, and the two grandsons were sitting in one of these little train seats, these miniature trains, with my wife, their grandmother, and then I was sitting with my son behind them. But I made the whole Periscope as if I was taking my 32-year-old son on a little toy train in the zoo. And he was so embarrassed. I would be yelling to people, this is my 32-year-old son. And I interviewed him, what was this like to be with daddy on this train? And so I do some really weird things. But effective October 1, I'm periscoping seriously. And every Thursday at 2 o'clock, I'm going to have a scope on something about the local church and leadership.
That's fantastic. That'll be
so
awesome.
I know Periscope is probably too simple and everybody knows it's out there, but I'm punching that one a whole lot.
You know, that's probably the number one tool that I've heard pastors use. And you know, something that's interesting, I get asked to write about faith in the business world all the time. What can CEOs learn from pastors? And one of the things that, that pastors really seem to have tapped into, the business world's lagging on, is things like Periscope.
Because, really?
Yeah, absolutely. Twitter moved one of their C-suite people, the only one that doesn't live in the Bay Area in San Francisco, moved them to Atlanta so they could be in close proximity to a high number of megachurch pastors. Because the retweet per follower is higher for megachurch pastors than it is for Justin Bieber or Oprah Winfrey or...
Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty cool to see how the church is kind of leading the charge and not bringing up the rear on that kind of thing.
Oh. It's another Roman road in terms of ways that the gospel can go. And you're right. When these things open up, it's a great opportunity for us.
Well, last question, just to kind of lift all of our spirits. A lot of us get on stage on Sunday and kind of mess things up a little bit and then get depressed. And it's helpful to hear our guests tell a time when maybe they missed the ball on stage. Can you share with us something from the Tom Rainer blooper reel?
Well, you know, there are two ways we can do this, William. We can do a blooper that is verbal, or we can do a blooper that is nonverbal. Unfortunately, some of the verbal bloopers that I come out with actually sounded like profanity. And so, I've seen some of the ladies that just eyes went wide open when they thought they heard I said something. So I'm not going to say those on a podcast. Those are the ones that come to mind right away. One of them that is not verbal, which was nonverbal, I guess I was preaching with a little intensity, and during one of my most profound moments, I must have bent a certain way, and my pants ripped in the back from, I would say it was a good 7 inches, the entire seam of my buttocks, and didn't have on a coat, and at the time had a choir behind me, and there was a white flag waving from the back of my pants and my underwear. And you know, how do you get out of that? There's no way to turn. There's you turn the other way and you got the whole congregation seeing that. I tried to act like it didn't happen, but the choir members just lost it. They just absolutely lost it. And you know, I guess I'm glad we've moved forward a little bit, and today the praise band would be sitting down, and you wouldn't have that issue. But.
Well, may the Lord be your rear guard, Tom.
I am
so thankful for you and the good work you're doing at Lifeway. It's amazing to see the turnaround. What a great resource for the church. Thank you for being with us today. Really appreciate your friendship and taking time to be with us on the podcast.
William, it's always a joy to be here with you in any capacity, and thanks for letting me be on this podcast.
Thanks for listening to today's podcast. Be sure to go to Vandercast.com, that's Vandercast.com, to sign up for Dr. Rainer's free webinar on church revitalization. We'd also love to see your takeaways from today's episode using the hashtag Vandercast. That's #Vandercast.